Hello and welcome to the Geeks Review. I'm Royce.
I'm Paige.
Today we'll be discussing Enola Holmes, but first my review of Lovecraft Country. Lovecraft Country is a new series airing on Foxtel Showcase. As of the time of recording, about half the season is done. However, I've only seen the first few episodes. The series stars Jonathan Majors, Journey Smollett-Bell from Birds of Prey, Courtney B. Vance, and Michael K. Williams from The Wire. Set in 1950s America, Majors plays Atticus, a young African-American man and Korean War veteran who has a love of all things sci-fi, fantasy, and horror, who's received a letter from his estranged father, played by Williams, asking him to travel across the country from Chicago to Massachusetts. And so Atticus sets off with his old friend Letty, played by Journey Smollett-Bell, and his uncle, played by Vance, encountering racists, horrific monsters, and not to mention the blood-sucking freaks. Arriving in Massachusetts, they encounter strange cults, vengeful spirits, and a whole lot of other gory monsters. The series is based on a novel of the same name by Matt Ruff, but it takes its name and inspiration from H.P. Lovecraft, a prolific writer of cosmic horror from the early 20th century, still widely loved and appreciated to this day, whose writings continue to be influential on stories like Aliens and undoubtedly Stranger Things. One thing fans of Lovecraft have had to contend with was the man was incredibly bigoted, even for the time, themes which carry over to this series, which deals with all manner of racism, violence to segregation and more. Some of the most powerful horror in the series comes in that form. Even when the monsters show up and start ripping people apart, it's somewhat of a relief as these otherworldly creatures that feast on humans is kind of understandable in comparison to the almost incomprehensible bigotry the heroes face, ironic as Lovecraft dealt with horrors beyond understanding. The series is incredibly gory and disturbing. A lot of that violence happens to the racist villains, and the series kind of revels in it, lingering on shots of gushing wounds. But the antagonists themselves seem kind of one-dimensional, all cut from the same cloth. They're infuriating and they do their job to serve as villains you want to see removed, but their constant, unrelenting campaign of hatred is just tiring and emotionally draining. I think now in this day and age, hearing constant bad news from a country that has dominated our headlines for decades, especially the last 4 years where villains like those in the show continue to rear their ugly head in real life, escapism would be better. I'm interested to see where it goes. I've heard there's some historical cameos coming up, painter Frida Kahlo being one of them, and the actors are all great. Majors has just been cast as a major character coming up in the MCU, and if you're looking for some bloody and very unsettling horror, if you're a fan of the actors like Michael K. Williams and Journey Smollett-Bell, check it out. Enola Holmes is a new film that recently came to Netflix, starring Millie Bobby Brown from Stranger Things as the titular heroine, the teenage sister of the famous detective Sherlock Holmes, played in this film by Henry Cavill, of Man of Steel and The Witcher. After their mother, played by Helena Bonham Carter, goes missing, Enola goes on an adventure to find her mother and becomes embroiled in a political mystery involving a missing marquess, assassins, suffragettes, and more against a Victorian London backdrop. The film also features notable British actors like David Bamber and Francis Delacour, alongside Sam Claflin, as the older, snottier Holmes brother, Mycroft.
I loved it. I actually really, really enjoyed it. I didn't really go in with any expectations. I'd seen the trailers, so I had a rough idea of what the film might be like. But I was quite surprised at everything that was sort of packed into it, but it wasn't too much. It wasn't overwhelming, and it was quite fun to watch.
Yeah, I mean, this is based upon a book series.
Yes.
I'd heard of it, I think. Prior to this.
Okay, I hadn't.
Yeah, it might just be like something else. I confused it with Nancy Drew or something. But I mean, the topic of having like a teenage sister of Sherlock Holmes is an interesting one, and maybe other people have done it. But yeah, this is, and I quite like this as well. I didn't see any of the trailers. I had no idea any of this. I mean, I've seen Sam Claflin and Henry Cavill and other things, as well as the other actors, but I've never seen Stranger Things.
Okay.
Have you?
I've seen the first season, so. But in saying that, that was quite a few years ago for Millie. She was quite young and now she's quite that little bit older. She's got a really good range on her. So Stranger Things, she's obviously this more violent, kind of quiet.
Troubled teenager.
She's barely a teenager. She's quite young. So now seeing her as this young woman as such, because that's what the film is really trying to get her to be, it's really quite sweet, and she's quite a good actress. Reminded me quite a bit of Emma Watson.
Yeah, I was going to say, watching this, it sort of reminded me of something that maybe Anne Hathaway or Natalie Portman would have been in like 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And, you know, that you can sort of see her going on to become a great actress like those
definitely.
Two. I mean, she even looks a bit like Portman.
Yes.
But yeah, this was my first time I'd seen her. And yeah, she's really good. I didn't know she was actually English until the film began. I just assumed, you know, she was American, putting on an English accent, but no, she's English. Yeah, I really liked it. And it's quite a long film as well, this one.
It is. It's just over 2 hours.
Yeah, and I thought it was going to be a Netflix series.
Oh, okay. So,
before I actually found out it was a film, I thought it was just a TV show, and I thought, oh, gosh, that's 10 episodes I need to watch. But no, it's just a 1-2-and-a-bit-hour thing.
Yep. See, I hadn't heard of it coming at all. I just saw it advertised on Netflix, and for that split second when I first saw it, I did think the same, maybe a TV show. Yeah. But I immediately watched the trailer, so I knew it was a film. And
well, I mean, you've gone and got Henry Cavill and Millie Bobby Brown, who are both Netflix stars in a way. I mean, he's been in The Witcher, which is a big Netflix series. She's in Stranger Things, which is Netflix original.
Yeah.
So I just assumed, oh, okay. And it turns out this was actually going to be released to cinemas, but because of, you know, COVID-19, it's a Netflix thing. It's probably because they've got those two in it. They've managed to get it.
Yeah. So when I first saw the trailer, I saw obviously that there was a bit to do with it. There was the character of the young man. Who was he? The Viscount?
Yeah, something like that. Didn't get his name.
Viscount Tewkesbury, that's it. Viscount Tewkesbury was introduced, but also the whole point of the trailer was that her mother had disappeared. So those sort of two things were introduced in the trailer, but not much information otherwise was given. So when the movie started, there was so much more introduced that wasn't given away in the trailer, which is actually a fault of, I find, a lot of Netflix films. You get more information given than you probably should, so you have a pretty good guess as to what the film's going to have happened. But there wasn't a lot given away, so when watching the film, there was so much more going on, but not too much that it felt really overwhelmed or clogged up, or you should have been like, no, they should have been a TV series. I think it would have been quite well done if it was a TV series, but yeah. I also enjoyed it as a movie.
Well, as a TV series, I mean, Sherlock Holmes is naturally sort of like a series of stories. I mean, even the series Sherlock, which we won't talk too much about, you know, is kind of a mystery every episode.
Yeah.
And sometimes there's an ongoing plot. But with this, I think, if it had been maybe the first, because there is a book series and there is talk now about there potentially being a sequel based upon the next book. Not too sure how loyal this is to the first book.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, that could have been cool, you know, to have like slightly longer episodes based upon each book. But the film, obviously, that's what it was intended to be, you know, it's not a Netflix series, but maybe Netflix will do something with it now that they've got it. And again, yeah, I didn't have any idea where it was going to go. I will say as well, it's it really does establish her as being the great detective, you know, because there's going to be someone out there who's like, she's a girl, why does she know how to do all this stuff? But it does show you, it does have flashbacks constantly showing that her mother obviously instilled in her all these skills, this knowledge, this passion for learning and discovering things and fighting, which she obviously gave to Sherlock as well, which is why he's gone off to become a great detective. And it's how she can also go into these situations which she's prepared for, even at 16 years old, if that's how old the character's also meant to be, maybe younger, and just work her way through all of this and deal with it.
Yeah, well, I think as well, the film kind of prepped itself for those kinds of people that will come through going, oh, well, how does she know how to do all this? Because she answers it to other characters, that question, because girls are meant to be young ladies and they're meant to be going to finishing school and that sort of thing. I mean, even Mycroft pushes that, but she found ways to intertwine into the story how she knows those things. And I think those flashbacks were really quite cleverly done. And quite a sweet, poignant sort of moment between her and her mother, and the fact that it was just her and her mother for so long.
It does also establish as well the connection she had with her mother by having all these flashbacks. You actually see them interacting, like, even after her mother's gone missing. Because, I mean, a similar streaming movie you were on board, which we reviewed a few months ago, was Artemis Fowl.
Yes.
Where his father just disappeared at the beginning of the film. Had no connection. I mean, he's his father, so of course you can sort of come up with that yourself. But we didn't actually see them interact until later on in the film. But with this, you go see them interact before she goes missing through flashbacks, so you kind of have that connection already. So when, or maybe if she doesn't show up at the end, not spoilers or anything, you do have that connection already.
Yeah.
Which was quite good.
And they had little things as well throughout the movie, such as their little nicknames for each other and things that Mycroft and Sherlock ultimately don't know because they had been a separate part of her life. I mean, for example, this is shown in the trailer, so it's not exactly a spoiler, but Mycroft and Sherlock literally walk past Enola at the train station when she's there to pick them up, and she just looks at them like, guys, come on.
Yeah, they don't recognise her because I saw her when she was a
child. Yeah. So there is that disconnect because it's obviously probably, I'd say, maybe a 15-year age gap. Yeah. The story is her mother goes missing on the 16th, the day of her 16th birthday.
Right, so she is 16, yeah.
She is 16, yeah. So I'd say Sherlock would be late 20s, early 30s at that point.
Yeah, maybe the early 30s, yeah.
And Mycroft was only a couple of years older, so they obviously grew up together. And they also had their father, and then their father...
Who's out of the picture altogether.
Well, he died shortly after Enola was born.
Yeah. So, I mean, young adult novel, you sort of think, like, oh, that's going to be a plot point that comes in later. But I think if it's based... you know, more directly upon Sherlock Holmes' mythos, it's going to be, you know, he's out of the picture altogether, probably.
Yeah.
Did you actually see there was a lawsuit by the Arthur Conan Doyle Foundation or Trust or whatever it is against Netflix because this film depicted Sherlock Holmes as having emotions, which was not outside the copyright because Sherlock Holmes only appeared with emotions in books that were published in the 1920s or something.
No, I didn't see that, but that's...
Something really just petty and pathetic. It's like, you can't use this Sherlock because he's actually nice. Mycroft is a real piece of work in this. He's horrible.
He is, which was quite interesting to see, but then also perhaps somewhat understandable. So I'm thinking maybe something that, I mean, I guess... the audience could work out for themselves or might be alluded to later, is that Mycroft perhaps is his father, Sherlock is a combination of both his parents, and Enola is very clearly her mother.
Right, that makes sense, yeah.
So perhaps that is why the boys are so stoic and why Enola got away with so much, because it was suddenly just her and her mum and they had this freedom to do what they wanted. And maybe her mother had been under a bit of like a lock and... key kind of situation.
Potentially, yeah.
Because, I mean, if he died, perhaps he was much, much older, which tends to happen in those kinds of times.
Yeah, I mean, you can speculate about all that sort of stuff. I mean, going back to what you were saying a few minutes ago, Millie Bobby Brown was actually a producer on this, so she had quite a lot of say, and she actually dictated to the writer. It makes it sound bad, but she did say to the writer, I'd like to have, like, you know, fourth wall breaking, so she does turn to the camera quite a lot of time and directly address the camera, the audience, and say, this is how I know this thing, or this is reminds me of this, or this was this thing, this is what I thought in this moment. And that was good, you know, it was sort of more naturally done.
Yeah.
Because it sets it up from the go, and it doesn't ever stray away from that.
Yeah.
I will say there is a bit of a tonal shift towards the end, like the ending becomes quite dark, like literally and figuratively, like there's a shootout in a darkened mansion, and I sort of thought they went directions which were quite horrific, killing characters off.
Yeah, I mean, one of the moments did literally make me jump. Mm. You were a bit like, whoa, okay, that happened.
And even she gets smacked around the head and she's like bleeding from her
head.
Which, this is rated M. Mm-hmm. It's a young adult, you know, novel, movie, I should say. But, you know, I think even Hunger Games sort of, you know, strayed away from direct depictions of blood, gore, more explicit violence. I mean, people get shot with arrows and stabbed and all that, but you didn't see, like, spurting blood.
That's true.
And that was a bit surprising.
Yeah, but I guess, obviously, like, things like makeup and such has changed, and that kind of expectation from the audience, too. They're expecting something more realistic. And
yeah,
I think because the film had been so bright and light throughout the whole beginning, when you did get to that dark point, you were kind of like, oh, wow, okay, this is actually quite serious. So
yeah, it was proper peril therein.
Yeah. So, but I really did like how they played with the colour and the lighting throughout the film. I loved how light and bright it was. And
yeah, it's a very colourful Victorian-era London. Mm. Or maybe it's much more true to life because you see a lot of things and it's dreary, it's grey and depressing.
Yeah.
And I don't remember if there are any shots of, like, the staples, like Tower Bridge or Big Ben, like the Houses of Parliament.
No, there wasn't.
It could have just been any, you know, Victorian-era London. Yeah. Or Victorian-era city, I should say. Like, it could have been Manchester, it could have been Glasgow, Bristol, whatever.
Yeah. I think as well, perhaps the reason it is so light and bright compared to perhaps other films set in that time is because it's through Enola's eyes. And
yeah,
she does seem to have this kind of positivity about her, even though she she starts off the film by saying, well, my name is Alone backwards and
yeah,
that sort of thing. So she's got that kind of always stuck in the back of her head, but she tries to be positive and she tries to see, well, literally the film does center a lot about around flowers. So she's always, there's a lot of flowers throughout the film and they're always there and they're quite light and they're quite bright. And I guess it doesn't go to dark until she's literally in a dark moment where she is so scared and terrified for her life. So
yeah,
I like how that kind of plays on it too.
That assassin as well was played by Bern Gorman, who you mm-hmm. might remember as Owen from Torchwood.
That's where I've seen him.
Yes. Also, he was in Pacific Rim, but I guess Torchwood is where he's big from.
Yeah.
Because this film was so long, you sort of think like, okay, how accurate is this then to the book? Because, you know, a young adult book you can usually pick up and read within a few hours, depending upon, you know, how quick a reader you are. So I was wondering, like, there are quite a few scenes in this which sort of seem like, okay, this is almost directly from the book.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this would be in there, and there are a few asides. There were a few things, sort of factual errors.
Yep.
I guess I had an issue with, but there was something which I found to be quite refreshing and interesting to see, like there's that lady, she's a suffragette, and Sherlock goes to talk to her, and she goes and asks him, do you have any interest in politics, Mr. Holmes? And he goes, no, I don't, because, I mean, that's Sherlock. He doesn't
yep.
care about that sort of stuff. And she goes, well, you've got no interest in changing things that don't impact you.
Yeah.
Or something to that effect, which is like, I mean, she's a black woman in Victorian era London,
mm-hmm.
and she's, you know, women can't even vote at this time. That's what the suffragettes were for. We're trying mm-hmm. to get, you know, women's rights to vote. And I thought that was quite interesting, and it's quite kind of a moment like, oh, yeah, that's cool, to really mm-hmm. focus in on that. But then the moments where it's like she's complaining about wearing stiff and awkward corsets and, like, tying herself into them. In real life, I mean, sort of corsets were seen to be quite liberating by women at the time. And, you know, just a necessary thing. I mean, obviously some women would have, but
yeah,
it's another one of those things like she's not like other girls, so she doesn't like the corsets. And
yeah, but I guess that also comes down to her upbringing too. I don't really
yeah.
think, like, it was literally just her and her mother, and they had
maid. True.
So
yeah, like, she wasn't out in society.
No, and her mother obviously wasn't one for corsets, and when you're fighting, you don't really want to be strapped in. So, but yeah, no, I understand that too. And I think it was really interesting that they did really keep that quite, just, well, this is blunt and to the point with their view on politics and such. And it
yeah.
was a bit almost quite relevant to today as well.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
which, I mean, most things like that are. But interesting to see how they kept that quite just, well, it is what it is. And if you don't have an opinion on it, then you don't really have a say. So that was quite
yeah.
nice to see. Well, and see the suffragettes as quite modern forward thinkers, which
yes.
they were. That was
yeah.
the whole point of them. Rather than just these women that were burning their bras, they actually had thoughts and
or blowing up post boxes.
Yeah. Exactly. They were given a characterization rather than just a sort of violent group. Mm.
The film definitely focuses a lot on Enola.
Mm.
But obviously we've gone and got Sherlock and Mycroft and Lestrade as well, returning characters from the lore, who've also featured quite prominently in recent, you know, Sherlock Holmes adaptations.
Yep.
I mean, obviously Sherlock, you've gone and got the Robert Downey Jr. Sherlock Holmes movie.
Mm-hmm.
You've gone and got Elementary with Johnny Lee Miller.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, how do you think they sort of compared to this? Because, like I said, Mycroft is quite nasty in this. Before, he's played by Mark Gatiss in Sherlock. He's a bit curmudgeonly
mm-hmm.
and a bit rude at times, but he's not like a horrible man.
Mm-hmm.
Not exactly. And then Stephen Fry in the Sherlock Holmes movies is Mycroft. And Reese Ifans in Elementary, who's a restaurateur as opposed to, you know, a government agent or anything.
Yeah.
Although maybe he is, spoilers. but yeah, how do you think that all compared, like the actual Sherlock and himself and all that?
Well, I found it to be believable, to be honest. Reason being, now I'm thinking about it, is that the Sherlock from the TV series, he was, as you said, quite rude at points and a bit blunt and to the point. And I guess he was in this too, but then you also have to realise that he had almost an anger in Enola because he found out his money had been getting sent to them and was getting withheld, and the house was run down. And so I guess also you can give him a little bit of leniency for that, for perhaps being a bit angry because of he had this idea of what was going on and what he thought was going on wasn't. But also, if perhaps you think about the thought of he's more like his father.
Yeah.
We don't really know exactly what his father was like. So perhaps when he's home and around Sherlock and out of his government setting, bit of a jerk.
He did scream in Enola's face and make her cry, which was a bit uncomfortable.
Yeah, that
it's
was
very
bit...
like, oh, wow, okay, you're not nice.
Yeah, but also it can be, it was quite an emotional reaction.
Yeah.
So that was nice to see him emotional. Not a nice reaction, obviously, but also it was good to see that the character was...
Not a robot.
Not a robot, yeah. So I think maybe that's it too of... Sherlock and and his brother have always been sort of a bit robotic.
Yeah, we are talking about Mycroft here, who is the dickish one in this. Sherlock himself is actually quite nice in this, in comparison, I think, to the more grumpy Cumberbatch Sherlock. And, you know, he's quite warm and he's sort of... He does come around to seeing Enola's point of view and helping her, and he loves her in his own way. And very dashing as well.
I guess that's, again... The emotion has been brought in rather than just one emotion. He's got a whole range, and that's more unusual to see in Sherlock. But also I think I'm glad that they did go a somewhat sweet side with Henry Cavill, because Henry is quite a rounded actor too. And in general life, I mean, he's obviously gained a lot of interest recently due to Witcher. So he's growing quite a large
fan base. Completely different from that as well, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I've not seen Witcher, but I know from Witcher he's grown quite a large fan base and obviously grown a lot of female interest. So the fact that he did have this sort of softer side was quite nice to see. And I guess if the movie is technically through Enola's eyes, little things that he might have been doing had been more exaggerated in her mind.
Potentially, yeah. But he is... Yeah, very understanding and helpful of her, which is nice.
But again, maybe coming home to the home setting has softened him a bit and hardened Mycroft a bit, so that could also be something that has happened.
Another similarity I noticed to the Guy Ritchie Sherlock Holmes film of Robert Downey Jr. was there was a very similar laboratory which they both broke into, and there's then a fight, although the one in the Sherlock Holmes film movie leads to, like, you know, a ship being blown up and a big fight across London. Whereas this is more sort of like a scuffle in an alleyway and some fireworks going off.
Yep.
But yeah, it was a sort of strange similarity there. I quite like this film, and I suppose it is more for... It is like a young adult film, I'd say, but I think anyone of any age can sort of enjoy this. It is very long, though.
It is very long, but in saying that, I think I would go back and watch it again in a couple of weeks, perhaps, just...
Yeah.
And I would see things that I missed the first time, but I would still enjoy it. It's not one that I'd go and switch back on immediately, but I would add it to a list of favourites and possibly enjoy it again.
I think with having Millie Bobby Brown having such a creative influence over this as well, which is crazy because she's like only 15 or something when this was made. That was like if Emma Watson was really dictating what was happening with Hermione and Harry Potter. But yeah, I think because she is a fan of it, this could probably be really accurate and really loyal and something that fans of the book would really love and maybe get interest in those books as well.
Yeah, I would definitely be one to be like, oh, maybe I could go and find the book and
For sure.
See what's going on. Which is really nice. It's nice to have a book, have a movie inspire you to go and read. I haven't had that for a while.
Especially not after Artem's Fowl.
No, I was more interested in Matt's interpretation of the books than the actual film. So, yeah, it's nice to feel inspired by a movie again. And I think that's what Enola Holmes wanted to do, and I'm glad it did.
Enola Holmes is available to watch on Netflix. And that's the show for today. Thank you for listening. Today we discussed Enola Holmes and the series Lovecraft Country. You can catch Enola Holmes on Netflix and Lovecraft Country, if it sounds interesting, keeping in mind it's incredibly gory, on Foxtel Showcase. I'm Royce.
And I'm Paige.
And we'll see you next time.